church as usual, showing up. We made it. We're here. God doesn't want anything as usual, but He wants to do a new thing. He wants to do a new thing in you, not if it's just passing by you and going to the next person, but in you. He wants to touch you with the glory of heaven. He wants to take you to a realm that you've never experienced before in Him. He wants you to know His glory and His presence. He wants you to be endued with power from on high, that explosive power of the Holy Ghost that leads you over into the realms of heaven, the realms of glory, and causes you to see things that you cannot even comprehend or didn't know that existed. Things that eye has never seen or ear has never heard or has never entered into the heart of man. He wants to bring these things as into reality in you. In you, in you. He wants you to explode with the glory of His presence. He wants you to come over here. He wants you to come over here to the river that is flowing out. He wants you to come and dine at His table. He has called you to come up into the realm of glory, to come up into the realm of His presence, to live, to walk out everything that He's called you to do and to be. Zopatelo. By the Holy Ghost. By the Holy Ghost. By the Holy Ghost. He wants to open your eyes tonight that you can see and behold Him like you never have before, because He is infinite. He is the beginning, the end, the Alpha, the Omega. He is eternity. And we've only begun to see and behold Him. We've only begun. Because people, when we see Him and we behold Him, we're captivated by the heart of God and the purpose of God. We're captivated by His heart. We're captivated by what He is doing. He wants us to see what He is doing. He wants us to behold Him. Not be distracted by this earth. There are so many distractions set out upon this earth to allure us, to entangle us, to keep us out of this realm of glory, to keep us out of this realm of His presence, to keep us caught up in the natural realm of man. There's so much entertainment designed to allure us that we don't even comprehend in this day, in this time. Because we're so desensitized to this earth and this world that we live in, that Jesus fits somewhere in there as far as spending time with Him, just to hear His voice, just to listen to what He's saying, just to behold Him and see Him. We don't want to be like those that had ears to hear but could not hear, or eyes to see and could not see. We don't want to be a church that's blind, deaf, and dumb. But we want to be a church that manifests the glory of God. Oh, hallelujah. You know, the glory of God is so present in this earth, so present in this place, so present and ready and willing to move in His behalf through anyone that will surrender themselves to Him and not fashion themselves after this world. Get their love and their lust and their desire off of this world. People go, lust, oh, I don't have lust. Well, lust, strong desire. Things that we put more time into than we put into the Father. Things that allure us and attract us. The church across America and the nations of the world is so sadly sleeping, asleep. People are just working on being able to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling, which is a good thing. But I'm afraid the fear and trembling's not there. They're at the part of working out their own salvation of what can I get away with and still go to heaven. That's not what is omitted and what is said. But it's really the subconsciousness of a person that is not red hot on fire for God. And if you're not red hot on fire for God, then you're either cold or you're making God sick and he's about to vomit. Amen. That's not a pretty sight. That's not a sight that gets into heaven. That's one spewed out of his mouth. That's not one watching and praying and seeking the Father. That's one that makes God sick. I wouldn't want to be one that made God sick, would you? He's called us to live out our life in this world in him and through him. The Father in us, the Son in us, us and the Father, us and the Son, one in him, to lose our life that we might find it. You save your life. You hold on. You hold on to this earth and this world, and you figure it all out, and you lay it all up, and you set it all aside, and you've got this bank account for this, and this for that, and the other for the other thing, and you've got it figured out, and this is the way it's going to happen, and this is the way it goes, and this is the way our society is, and this is what must be done. So this is what we do. Put it all away. Clear the table. Wipe the slate clean. Start over with the chalkboard and say, Father, today I'm getting up, Lord Jesus. I'm waking up this morning. Holy Spirit, what are you doing today? Because I belong to the one who loved me and died for me and gave himself for me. So what are you doing, Father? I want to hear what you're doing by the Holy Spirit. I want to get out of this gate that's just set up for humanity. Everybody goes down the gate and through the chute, and this is the way it is, because this is the way society demands for it to be. It's a broad gate that leads to destruction. It's not the narrow gate that hears the voice of the Father that says, come over here, come on, step outside of everything you know, everything you understand, and be the man, the woman, the child that I've called you to be. Separate yourself to me. Amen. Separate yourself to me. And be that person I've called you to be. We don't even comprehend. We don't even comprehend in the church today the separation of holiness, the fear of God, the fear of the Lord, which is to hate evil and how much he hates it. He hates evil so much that he created an eternal hell fire full of torment and torture for the devil and his evil imps that rebelled against him. He didn't create it for one of men, because he wills that all men come to him. But unfortunately, every man's not going to choose him. But it's his heart's desire. And he goes to the ends of the earth, and he looks for people that are willing to go to the ends of the earth and obey his commandment, where he said, go ye into all the earth and preach the gospel. He first commanded us to go and wait for the promise of the Father to be endued with the Holy Ghost to empower us. And he empowered us with all of heaven. All of heaven. He empowered us. It's like a great army and a great country that has all the latest technology in our artillery. They have the best planes, the best bombs, the best whatever there is for a battle. They're the biggest, the strongest country that the earth knows. And there's this little, teeny, stripped of all its real power, just breathing out its threatenings like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. This little small army that cannot compare to the power of this great nation yet the great nation stands there and watches as their small little enemy comes and just walks right over the power and the authority that they have in Christ Jesus. Too busy thinking about their own life and living what they're living out to realize the power and the authority that he gave us to do what? To sit around on our blessed assurance with it? And let the enemy run right over us? I mean, how dumb would we think it is to see a nation so powerful and to let a little enemy come and just tromp over them? How dumb would we think that is? I think it's playing out because of the spiritual atmosphere in the church. I think it's playing out in the natural. Because we were the greatest nation when God was first, when God was more important than anything. And every bit of what's going on in the United States of America today and throughout the earth is because the church has abdicated, because the church has not taken hold of the power and the authority handed to us when Jesus completed and finished the work and sent the Holy Ghost to empower us. This many people in this room today could shake the nations of the world if they were on fire with the Holy Ghost and demonstrating the power of God that lives on the inside of us and is just waiting for us to believe what he said and let it out. Amen. Just activate and believe. Sadly to say, we have to start with square one. Sadly to say, we have to go back. Do we believe the love that God has for us? Do we really believe the love that God has for us? You know, if we believe the love that God has for us, we are going to abundantly love him. When we believe the Almighty God, the creator of the earth, and I mean, I think we get blinded to the fact that he who created all things, the Almighty God, lives and dwells on the inside of us. I think we're desensitized to it because we're so busy about us. We don't believe that seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these things shall be added unto you. We feel like we have to add all these things unto us and then we can go and seek first the kingdom of God. We believe that we have to fix it and we have to do it. And we can't step out and believe God. Let's just put it where it's at. Because I tell you, I don't care who you are, how old you are, you get on your face before God, you get alone with God, and he will commission you. He will commission you. He will say, here are your orders. Go and fulfill them. And he'll give you only so much at a time, but if you obey what he gives you, he will continue giving you his orders, his direction, his provision, his empowerment, because we have it. We have it. But we're like the great army that isn't using the finest technology of the earth today, and even greater, the all power in heaven and earth, the one with the power that spoke earth into existence. He just spoke it. Whatever he says, whatever he speaks, must come into existence. Whatever he wills. But you know what he wills? He wills that you have your will to choose. Each and every day, will you follow him? Will you get up and deny yourself and follow Jesus? Will you lose your life in this world so you can save your life through eternity? Will you get off this little blip of the radar where you think you've got to have everything and look at the vastness of eternity and behold the creator of all the universe that wills and desires to empower you to be great in the earth today and make his name great in the earth. He wants to empower you. He's waiting to empower you. He's not waiting for you to get good enough or figure it out, because I'm going to tell you simply, if you believe the love that God has for you and you love him Because you're captivated by that love that he has for you, because you believe it. Because you believe that he is a God that means what it says and his word is true. And one day there will be great judgment. And there's judgment on your life if you don't walk with him. And so you take a hold of that fear of God and you believe it. You believe that love. Out of that love, you're going to keep his commandments. Not out of a have to, not out of a need to, but out of, I believe God. I believe him. I believe his word is true. It's not something that we just want to say. Let it come out of our mouth or hear. It's something that we want to explode on the inside of us. And we want to make sure that that fire is stirred and kindled all the time because we believe God. We believe him. And we know what he says is going to come to pass. And we don't, not one of us, want to sit idly by and let the years of our life go by and not participate with what the Father's doing, because he wants to do great things through us right now. He wants to empower us with his glory and with his presence. And he's calling us to come to that place, to come to that place, to come to that place. You know, and the proof is in the action. As the old saying is, the proof's in the pudding. But the proof is so much more in the action. It's so much more than pudding. It's in the action. He said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by the love you have one for another. And we sit in the church trying to figure out, can we even love the people in the church? If we can't love the people in the church with all their problems and their issues, and it aggravates us right there that we can't love each other and we have to have a snooty attitude towards anyone, the least among us, then how can we love the world? Because I tell you what, when we bring them in, they're going to have their problems too. Yep. It's the love of the brethren with the problems that is the real example of Jesus. Because we see them and we see the eternity in, for them in the church. See, there's a world out there dying and going to hell. They're dropping off into eternity every day. Thousands are dying and going to hell every day. Father cares about those thousands that are dying and going to hell every day because they're slipping into eternity. And once they hit eternity, there is no hope for them. It is over. It is over for them. And he wants us to love them like he loves them. And it to be panting in our heart to reach them. But first of all, he wants us to love him, and then he wants us to love the church. He wants us to love the people that are right here in front of us. If we can't love the people right here in front of us, why do we want to bring the sinner in and then get mad at them and have a problem with them too? Loving gets down into the ditch, and it goes there. Right here in the church, it goes there where the problem is. And it's like, how can I help you? I love you. I want you to know I love you. And how can I bring you into that realm of Jesus? It's taking your time. It's taking your effort. It's taking everything when you see that there is a need and somebody's hurting and somebody could be falling off the edge, to get in there and to spend your life bringing them in all the way and encouraging them and settling them and strengthening them till they go into perfection. And you might say, well, they've had a lot of time. You know, hold up, go look in the mirror. So have you. Hold up, go and look in the mirror, because I'm going to tell you, there ain't nobody sitting in here on their little fanning right now that's perfect. Amen. You should be. But you haven't got it all together either. God's working things in you. God is working things in you. And how dare any of us have anything but the love and the compassions of God for every single person that he has placed in this place, for us to love all the way to him. We love God because he first loved us. That captivated us. His love, that he would deliver us from the powers of darkness and sin. We love him because he first loved us. And for us to slough off a person because we don't exactly mesh with them, or because they've heard and heard and heard and they haven't got it right. Well, Father says, neither do you, because you don't love them. Love goes deep down in there, and it bears all things. It endures all things. And it's determined to see one more soul anchored in him. Anchored in him. Set in him.
Amen.
Unmovable. Unchangeable. What is the ministry for? The apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. It's for the perfecting of the saints till we all come in. Maybe some people are coming in certain areas. Well, other people are coming in other areas. But everybody's got things that God's still working out in you. Because I tell you what, we're going to glow a whole lot more than we do. Oh, Jesus. You know, we want to get the love of God. We want to allow the love of God to be perfected in us so we can love the world. First of all, love our families. A lot of people don't love their families enough to see that so many people that literally are relatives to you, dying and going to hell. And how much time do you spend on your face before God crying out to God about what you can do to make a difference? How can you help them see Jesus and behold him so they'll turn around from their wicked ways and come follow Jesus? To humble ourselves and go and apologize to a family member because we haven't exactly treated them right? Is that too much humility? I say God dwells where there's humility. We don't have to stoop down to where they're at, but we can stoop down and be like Jesus and say, I'm willing to die to myself. I'm willing to die for you like Jesus did. And just loving on them. Simply loving on them. And getting in there and breaking through some of the stuff that caused them to be where they're at. You know, everybody's got their choices, and we can go, you know, they choose to go this way. We've all gone through the same things. And it's true. We all go through the same battles, and some people choose to just follow Jesus no matter what the pain is, no matter what the suffering is, no matter what. But some people need you to reach down there and pull them up. Because you think of that memory of people being in eternity. What if somebody you know that is on their way to hell, and let's just go with the family right now. What if they were to die tomorrow and you knew that they went to spend eternity in hell? And you didn't do everything that you could do to make it right. I tell you what, this is the basis of Christianity. This is the basis of people that walk with God. This is the basis of, this is just the basics of making sure that there is nothing else that you could do. That you know that you love them deeply. And you verbalized it. Not just, oh, I love them. But let me go over here and meet somebody new because I haven't got all up in their mess and they haven't bugged me yet. But if they, when they bugged me and they reject how I'm going to present Jesus. You know what? People don't even want Jesus until they know that you love them. Because they have not seen a real Jesus in this earth through the church. They've seen hypocrisy. And they don't even know what you're talking about. They don't even know what it means. So many of them have been evangelized with the numbers of, you say this prayer and you're on your way to heaven. And many, 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 many people think that they're on their way to heaven because they said a prayer one day because somebody told them that's all they had to do. And people have got to see a life that is different. A life that's lived out for Jesus. A life that takes a stand when everybody persecutes you and still loves. Still loves when the persecution's there. Still reaches out and you slap and you get slapped continually, but you still reach out. That's God-like. That's Jesus. That's what he's doing. Jesus moved out of compassion for the people. And he knew what was in man. He knew that they were just out there to get whatever they could. He let Judas carry the bag of money, and he wasn't a bit worried about it because he didn't care about the money. And he knew that Judas was a thief from the beginning, and Judas had that money, and that was all part of the mess that he was in. Jesus wasn't worried about it. We need to stop being worried about all the things in our life. We need to walk in the peace of God. When we know him, there's peace. When we know him, we know that he's going to take care of us and we don't have to figure it out for ourselves. We can walk through everything that that we have come our way in peace that passes all understanding. Because it's supposed to rule our hearts and our minds. That's what he's given us. That's that complete and total confidence in him that we have in him. That we don't have to get out the calculator and figure it out. We can pray the multiplication if we need to. Because we know that God is going to take care of our needs because we're about his business. We're doing what he's called us to do. We're being faithful with a few things so he can make us ruler over many things. And that's not when we get to heaven. That's now. He wants to make us ruler over many things. But it's out of relationship and fellowship. And it's staying in that relationship and fellowship. I mean, we can look at ourselves as the Church of Ephesus. Starting out doing good, everything right. And still continuing on doing good and moving forward and busy in the kingdom and busy doing the things of God. And just all of these things are right. And Jesus came to him and he said, all these things are good. But this is the one thing I have against you. Oh. The one thing, you've left your first love. And how it's measured is by how you love one another. That's how you know that the fire of God is burning in you. You're not going to get frustrated with one another. You're going to see how you can bring one another along. We don't want to just be preachers of the word, but we want to be participants and doers of the word. And we don't want to sit and be hearers and get up and go out of here and continue on the same way we've been. We want change because revival must come. Revival must come to the nation of America and the nations of the world. It must come for the sake of our children. Because if it does not, through us, what our children are going to have to endure in persecution in this earth, just go visit Syria right now and become part of that. Because if you think it's not going to hit our shores, wickedness is bringing down our country. Evil. And you know how it came through? You know how it got into our country? You know how it began in this country and got really strong and got a stronghold? Entertainment. Started through the worship of music that wasn't worshiping the Father. That has been a stronghold in our country for many years. We need a revival that so awakens our nation and the nations of the earth, one like the Azusa Street revival and the revival in Wales, yes, to where bars are shut down and people began to fall and tremble. I read about the revivals in the late 1800s in the United States of America. And people would even get close to the place where the minister was preaching, and they would begin to shake under the power of God. And people would come from everywhere to hear, and they'd climb up in trees to listen to the man that was preaching. And if they would resist the Holy Ghost, he would say, look, be careful, you might ought to come down out of those trees. Because if there was resistance, they would shake under the power of God so hard that they would fall out of the trees. Many people resisting God shook so hard that they broke their neck and literally fell down and died. I checked that book out of the library. I wanted to keep it, but the Bible says, thou shalt not steal. I tried to buy it, but they wouldn't let me buy it. We need an awakening, and it starts with every person sitting in the seat tonight. Being determined to have change in their life. To have your own real love relationship with Jesus Christ. That gets you up out of your seat and off your couch. Amen. And gets you busy about the Father's business, because it's a love relationship. And you want to obey what he said when he said, we can just look at Mark chapter 16. We want to say, I opened the Bible tonight. Oh, Jesus. In verse 15, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You hear Father's heart? Can you hear Father's heart? Can you hear his heart? Can you hear his cry? He was speaking to those that he was enduing with power from on high so they could be co-laborers with him. He that believes and baptized and is baptized shall be saved. And he that believeth not, he had the opportunity to hear. You gave him the opportunity to hear. You gave him the opportunity. At least you gave him the opportunity. How many live in the United States of America? I'm amazed at how many people. Well, now, because of the influx of immigrants coming into the United States of America, there is so many people that do not know the foundations of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They don't even know the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are some people that haven't even heard the gospel. I've preached to them. But I want more power to compel them to come in. And I know it's only going to come on my knees. The Lord's not just speaking to you out there. He's speaking to me right here. Because we must have revival. We must have a move of God. Amen. We must. We must have a move of God. We must get serious about it now. We've abdicated way too long. And the years are passing by. And Satan's running up the middle of our country. Taking hold with the minority. Not the majority. The minority. But the minority is becoming the majority. Because our kids are sent off to public school where they're completely desensitized, reprogrammed, and brainwashed. If you don't believe that, look at the statistics of how the vote's gone. They prepared the 18-year-olds when they come out of college to vote according to the way they wanted them to, and have dictated by the powers of darkness. Because Christians abdicated. Because we've left the job that we're supposed to be doing to the government. The government has no place. The church is supposed to lead, and the government's supposed to come to the church and ask the church what to do. That's the way God set it in order. The authority is to come from the church. You can look at Josiah. I've been reading about Josiah. And you know, God put Josiah on my heart a couple of weeks ago. Because Josiah postponed judgment. God was angry with Judah. He was done, and he was going to wipe Judah out. And then Josiah comes on the scene, and he begins to reign in Judah at 8 years old. And 8 years later, when he's 16 years old, he begins to seek the Lord. And as he seeks the Lord, he begins to tear down the altars, and he kills the priests that are offering up sacrifices to Satan. Let's just call it where it is so people will understand that. You're offering a sacrifice, and it's not to God, it's to the devil. and you can call it anything you want. You can put any little name on it you want. You can call it a Buddha. You can call it a Hindu. You can call it self-worship. You can call it whatever. You're offering up your sacrifice, the sacrifice of your life. It's to Satan. But Josiah came in and he began to purge. He even dug up the bones of the lying prophets, and he burnt them and he stamped them to powder so their remembrance would be completely removed. Completely removed, so nobody could even go to the sepulchres of the lying prophets and see their bones. He destroyed it out of Israel. I mean, revival was taking place under Josiah in the 12th year of his reign. Puts him about 21. 21 years old. And he's radical for God.
Amen.
And then he begins to restore the temple. And he commands them to restore the temple. And in the temple they find the Bible, the word, the law. We would say the Torah. They find the law. And they come and he says, read it to me. And they begin to read it to him, and he rent his clothes. And he said, God, have mercy on us. We're all dead men. The judgment of God is for sure on us because we're not even coming close. We're not even coming close to keeping the word. And I mean, this is after he's gone radically after restoring righteousness in Judah. He's torn down all the stuff. He's put the witches to death. And the warlocks and all of those that aren't following after God, he's put them to death. He's cut them off. He's killed the priest. And he finds the book of the law, and they begin to read it. And he goes, go to the prophetess, Helda. There's a name for you guys if you're going to have a girl. Go to the prophetess. And inquire of the Lord for us. Inquire of the Lord for us. And she speaks by the word of the Lord and says, truly judgment will come. But because Josiah, you humbled yourself before God and you sought his face and you trembled at his word, it will be postponed until you die and are gathered up with your fathers. Judgment was postponed because someone was willing to get up and have revival. Somebody was willing to get up and move in God. He commanded all of Judah to serve God, and you didn't serve God, it was it for you. I mean, he was radical about turning judgment. But the sad thing is it was still underlined all in the country, and all of the stuff was there. It was in people, and they didn't turn to God with their whole heart. Josiah did. Josiah had turned to God with his whole heart, and he feared and he trembled at the word. Do we fear and tremble at his word? Or do we go, yeah, my dad's been preaching that to me, or my mom's been preaching that to me my whole life, and I've heard that, and my grandfather, and you know, or whatever. Or they've been saying this stuff for ages, and we just skip over it, and we don't look at it that it's spirit and life, and we're not looking into the perfect law of liberty and letting it change us. It's not who we are. Because we don't believe it. When you believe it, you live it, you walk it out. And the only way you can believe it is believing and knowing God is true. I'm telling you, people, you can sit here and think that this isn't you, but I'm going to tell you there's a different action when people take a hold of God and they fear and they tremble at his word. There's a different response. There's a moving in God. And there's a refusing to allow yourself to be desensitized to this world and come under the form and the fashion of this world. And the reality of losing your life. If you don't hate mother or father or brother or sister for the kingdom. I want to read this. It's in Luke chapter 14. If any man come to me and hate not his father, his mother, his wife, his children, his brethren, and his sister, yea, in his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And his own life. Ask yourself, are you serving God or are you serving you? Because it's not 50-50. It's 100. You cannot be my disciple. And you say, well, hey, you just told me to love my brother and my sister and all my family. Well, this is, it's when it costs you to have to walk away from your mother, your brother, your sister, because they will not receive the gospel and they persecute you for it. And you like, okay, God, you know, I got to go back and try to fix things with my family because this is my mom and this is my dad and I got to take this a little bit easy and it's a little bit too much for them. And so I got to back up over here. And, you know, my mom and my dad, they love me. My brother and the sister, they love me. And they think I'm getting too radical for God. My friends, you know, my friends, they're my friends. And you mean I got to walk away from my friends? Everybody that I ever knew that came to Jesus out of the world had to walk away from their friends. They had to leave their life behind them. Every person must go to that place. Of though none go with me, I will follow you. Because it's your relationship with God and no one else's. It's you that will stand before him. And no one else will stand before you, before God for you. You will stand there alone by yourself. And mama and daddy can't fix it. And nobody else can fix it. That's why you have to make that decision if you're going to be his disciple. Because if you can't leave it all, you're not worthy to be his disciple. You can't be his disciple. He says it right here. I didn't write this. He did. And whosoever does not hear, whosoever does not bear his cross, and come after me, cannot be my disciple. We make all kinds of excuses for our situations and what we're in and what we're going through instead of bearing the cross that we're under. And we go sit down and rest a bit because it was a little too overwhelming. We got to check out and play some video games and just kind of relax or watch a TV and get caught up in a television or go to the movies or something just to chill for a little bit because it's just, it's too much. We might not say it's too much, but we're looking for some kind of entertainment or something to help us escape from the reality that God's dealing with us in. We're not willing to bear a cross. And we only really find the cross that we're to bear when we're on our face before him. And he's given us those instructions and that commission of what we're to do. If you let excuse keep you from the things that God's called you to do, then you now you will let excuses take you all the way into eternity to stand before God. And God doesn't take excuses. He laid it all out. If you let somebody, see, if you let somebody stumble you up in your relationship with God, that means that you need to go back to your first love. If you're looking to people, yeah, we're to follow Pastor Mark or whoever as they follow Christ, as they follow Christ. But if someone was to fall away from God, that should not affect us because we should have our relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. Our eyes are to be on him and not on a man. Right. You put your eyes on a man and idolize him, you'll be looking the wrong way. You'll be looking at the wrong thing. And then you'll start being able to see all kinds of imperfections. And then from there goes self-justification that, well, if they do it or if she does it, then why can't I? And, you know, so this is being put on me. People get over in this demeanor. This is being put on me and so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so does this, that, and the other. That's self-justification. That has nothing to do with relationship. That's over in the demonic realm. to justify yourself in anything is over in the demonic realm. We're over here in a love relationship with Jesus Christ, and we're walking with Him, and we're keeping His commandments because we're caught up in His love. Because we're in love with Him, because that fire is burning on the inside of us of what He has done for us. And out of that, His heart is bursting forth in us that we are compelled to preach the gospel. Compelled. I've never heard of a Christian that wasn't compelled to preach the gospel because they're not a Christian. They're sitting waiting to make up their mind if they're going to serve God. I'm just saying what's written right here in the Word. This is our life. This is who we are. This Word right here. Living and alive in us by the Spirit. Manifested to the world. Not manifested to your living room while you prop up your feet and sit in front of your TV. But manifest it to the world, because that's Father's heart. If we're ashamed at work to open our mouth about Jesus and preach the gospel to every person that God possibly gives us the opportunity to preach to, then when we stand before Him, He'll be ashamed of us. If we're ashamed to open our mouth in school, if we're ashamed to open our mouth in whatever environment we're in, then He'll be ashamed of us. And you might say, I'm not ashamed. Well, then what are you doing? What is it then? You tell me what it is. I'm waiting on the Holy Ghost. Well, you'd find the Holy Ghost if you got on your knees. Amen. And He would endue you with the power to speak.
That's right.
And you'd be finding somewhere to speak. I've preached many times in a grocery store. And the Lord holds up the groceries and bungles up the work so you have time to get the Word out. It's a platform, wherever there's a platform. And the platform can be one person, because God will send you all the way across the world for one person if you're willing to go. He may want thousands to hear, but if you go and one hears, all heaven's rejoicing. All heaven's exploding with total excitement over that one. And I tell you, I've been burdened for some people in here in this place, and I've been praying for you. Because I want you to be encouraged, and I want you to hear, and I don't want you to allow anything to stumble you up, and I don't want you to allow the enemy to bring any confusion to you. I want you to get your eyes on Jesus and off of people. Follow them as they follow Jesus. They're obeying the Word, follow them. If they're not, you just keep following Jesus. A love relationship with Him, because eternity is here in just a moment. It's in a moment. It's in a moment. It's in a moment. Time has just slipped by. It's gone by so fast. I don't know where it went. I definitely want to stand before Him with more than what I have now to bring into heaven. I look back at the souls that I brought to Jesus. And as much as I look at the souls that I have brought to Jesus for the first time coming to Jesus, as I look at the souls that God's allowed me to encourage and establish in His kingdom, that's just as imperative. Because if we knock them out of the church faster than we bring them in, what good is it to even bring any in? In verse 33 of Luke chapter 14, so likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsakes not all that he has, he cannot be my disciple. It's just bringing it down to reality. Reality. Are we entangled? Entangled in this earth in any way? You want to get up every morning and ask the Lord.
Yes.
You want to be real with God continually. Are you entangled? No man that warreth, no man that goes to war entangles himself in the affairs of this life that would keep him from the battle.
Amen.
And if you think that walking with God's not a battle, you're kidding yourself. There's a fight on your hands, but he's given you all the strength that you need. You keep yourself there. The way you keep yourself there, the way you keep yourself in the love of God, the principle, the foundation that everything in God grows on, the love of God, is by praying in the Holy Ghost, building yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, because that's the foundation. That's how you keep yourself in that love. That foundation is praying in the Holy Ghost. Because you understand, God is love. God is love. And he flows out of love. And he is a God of love that hates. He hates those things that would destroy your life for eternity in hell. He despises them. He knows the end of that little thing that Satan tries to get God's people to hold on to, or lures them away with. The lust of the eye, the pride of life. Thank you, Father. I just want everybody to stand with me. And I just pray that every person in this place continues to keep that love of God stirred in your heart. Not allowing running here and there, doing this, and the busyness of work and entertainment and what you got to do, you know, your exercise or your this or your that, that you would put more time into than that, and then just being still and being able to hear God. And then out of that, praying Father's heart by the Holy Ghost, so allowing that prayer of the Spirit to come up out of you that empowers you to function and operate in what the Father's doing and what the Father's saying. Get commissioned every day to be about his business. That's who we're supposed to be. That's what we're supposed to be doing. And if you're too busy, stop and be still. Stop. It just said, if you're not willing to lose every single thing in this life, if you're not willing to let it all go, then you're not worthy to be his disciple. You cannot. You cannot be his disciple. We cannot figure it out. And then we can move on to the Father's heart and reaching the lost and loving the lost and bringing them to Jesus. Because we've got about 3 million people here in San Diego, and most of them have no idea. There's a very small representation in San Diego of people that really walk with God and know God. And like I said, if this many people are radical for Jesus, we'll turn San Diego and this nation upside down, and even the world. This many people. So tell me that there's not something lacking in us. Yes, we're growing in God, but it's time to go at warp speed, because nobody else is doing it. It's time to get a hold of God. I tell you, I don't care who you are, how old you are, man, woman, boy, or girl. If you get alone with God and you put his word before you, he will empower you to speak words that you never comprehended, that you could even speak out. When you step out and you begin to do his business, you'll find all these scriptures that you didn't even know you memorized, but you read them and you put them in your heart, will come flowing out of your mouth, because Father is hooked up with you, because you're doing what he wants you to do. You're participating with the kingdom. And you'll find when you see that crippled lady or you see that child in a wheelchair, when you just go over out of the love and the compassion of God, when that compassion of God moves you and you go over there and you lay your hands upon that child's going to get up out of that wheelchair. This is what I feel Father's saying and what I feel He's doing. And we're going to see a change as we see a body of Christ step up and believe God and believe Him. So we can participate with Him. And I tell you, if you don't believe that you can participate with God, get back down on your knees and cry out to God for that first love to be rekindled. Do your first works over. I just want everybody to come up and we're just going to pray together. Father, we just thank You, Lord God. We just thank You, Father, that in the morning when we wake up, we're not going to be the same. When we leave here tonight, we're not going to be the same. Lord, but change, Father, change, Father, change. We're not going to be those that hear the word any longer and just go out and do the same old thing, but we're going to be those that hear the word and participate with Your word and activate, 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 activate in the kingdom. Because we are compelled by that love relationship that we have in You that settles everything, that settles all the sin issues, that settles everything with You, Father, compelled by Your Spirit. Father, I just pray right now for a fresh fire of the Holy Ghost, a fresh baptism, a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost. Father, we want to be like they were on the day of Pentecost, Father, staggering out drunk. Oh, Father God, for the winds of heaven to blow, the tongues of fire, Father, to set upon each and every one of us. Oh, God, the tongues of fire to settle upon each and every one of us. And us be endued with that power and stagger out of this place, Father. Changed by Your Spirit. Father, so endued with the Holy Ghost that we compel men to come to You and they have to obey. No longer is it a losing battle, but it's a winning battle because they have to obey as we compel them and command them to come to You. In Jesus' name. Father, birth prayer within us that takes a hold of heaven. And heaven moves on our behalf. And our prayers are answered every time because we are talking to a God that hears and sees. Thank You, Father. Father, cause us to know that You hear us. When we cry, and when we cry by the Spirit, Father, You're activating heaven to move on our behalf. Father, I thank You for a people that will cry out to You day and night until we see the moving of Your Spirit, till we receive, we see revival fire in the land today like never before. Oh God, that fire that You are burning right now. Lord, in the few that are willing to go. But Father, we ask You to turn it into all willing to go. All those that seek You. All those that claim to know You, Father, become set on fire with the fire of heaven. Father, Jesus. Jesus.